You know, and you asked about sales. You know, and I won't go into the details, but I will say, in the first quarter of 23, we've already done better than we did all of last year. And so we're growing, you know, and part of that is our market expansion. As we enter new markets, obviously, there's more revenue, more sales for us.
Do you think that marijuana should be legalized in every state?
Oh, of course, 100%. It never should have been illegal, I think is a better way to think about it.
Tell me about pre-game, halftime, and post-game.
Yeah, so a big part of the brand is helping people realize that cannabis is different than what they were taught it was. And because I'm an athlete, we bring sports into it. So pre-game is cannabis that's more going to get you focused and up, ready to do something. Post-game to help you relax, you know, help people sleep. And halftime is something that's kind of right in the middle. You know, you can take during the middle of the day and it'll keep you on that nice mid-range.
So I have sleep apnea that I've been diagnosed with. Would that help my sleep apnea?
It depends on the cause of the sleep apnea, but post game will definitely help you relax and help you sleep. You know, one of the things sleep apnea is related to breathing, and one of the things that scientists have found is cannabis relaxes our ability to breathe, and so it can definitely help with respiratory issues.
Did you smoke a lot as a saint?
I did not. I did not. I didn't start really until I was traded to Miami. I smoked a little bit as a saint, but not a lot.
And why did you start when you were traded to Miami?
So at the end of my time in New Orleans, right before I was traded, the end of that season, I broke one of my ribs, and it's a very painful injury and difficult to play. And I had a lot of difficulty sleeping. And so my roommate at the time suggested that I use cannabis, and it helped me sleep. And I started to also notice that it helped me become more introspective and reflective, and just the timing of it, you know, I started to get into it, and then I got traded, and I had access to it in Miami and guys on the team, and it started to become more a part of my daily practice.
Do you ever reflect on your time in New Orleans at all?
All the time. All the time. Yeah.
And what are those reflections like? Can you tell us?
Yeah, it's common, and I think you can relate. Maybe not everyone, but you can relate as you get a little bit older and you reflect on your younger years, you know? Usually it's laughter, you know, and realizing how dumb and inexperienced you were, and you know, but also there's compassion and understanding for the person you become. And so I grew up in New Orleans, you know. I came into New Orleans as a boy, and I left a man. So very powerful, meaningful experiences and people, you know? And I can always say, like, there's a piece of New Orleans that's in me. And that's never, I mean, I got the fleur-de-lis tattoo on my ankle, but deeper than that, there's something in New Orleans that's always going to be in me. And I feel it every single time I come back.
When's the last time you've been to New Orleans?
It was about a year ago. About a year ago, yeah.
And how did the people treat you?
Great. I mean, what I love about New Orleans is, you know, I played there what 20 over 20 years ago. Goodness gracious. And when I go back, you know, I go to the same restaurant, right? The same person that served me 20 over 20 years ago is still there, you know? And I have memories. Ah, it's that's rare, you know. I've traveled around the world. It's rare. It's rare.
The fact that they traded the entire draft for you, that put a lot of pressure on you, don't you think?
I mean, reflecting, yeah, but to me, when we look at athletes and the ones we celebrate, it's because of how they dealt with the pressure. And so for me, I understand that more pressure means a greater chance to be great. And so, yeah, it was pressure, but that's what I wanted. That's the reason I did my contract that way. You know, I think people misconstrue. People think that I was trying to be, you know, rich, wealthy. No, right? I just want to have experiences that push me to become better. And I knew, right? New Orleans wasn't easy. It was difficult, but there's no doubt it made me better. And it's not an accident that my time in New Orleans, I went to Miami in that first year. I led the NFL in rushing. Okay. It didn't happen on accident. The experiences I went through in New Orleans made me better.
So you don't regret the contract, even though Edgerrin James made a lot more money than you, right?
Listen. I live my life not with regrets, because the whole point of the contract, like I said, wasn't to make money. It was to make a statement. And the fact that people are still talking about the contract, no one's talking. I mean, Edgerrin's in the Hall of Fame, had a wonderful career, but no one's talking about his contract, you know? And I think even after I die, you know, people will still be talking about that contract.
Does that bother you?
No, I think, well, to me, I think I'm trying to be immortalized, you know? And it's in people, I mean, I know where your mind's going. I don't mean the contract, because people are viewing the contract through their limited understanding. But as time goes on, we have greater understanding and we appreciate the essence of something. And the point of the contract was just what I said earlier, is I wanted to create a situation that challenged me to play. If I would have gotten all a ton of money and I got hurt, you know, the same way I did, you know how miserable I would have been to feel like I was stealing? Oh, I don't think I could have lived with myself.
Not many players feel the way you do about it, though.
Well, I'm different. I'm different, and I'm okay with that.
You're good with it, right?
I've had to be. I mean, at first, social anxiety, I wasn't good with it. But eventually, I embraced that I'm different. It's more fun.
When you took the picture with the dress, any regrets about that?
No. No. You know, it's funny, because the thing about, I was naive when I was young, you know? I thought it was funny, and I thought people wouldn't care. I learned something, right? People were offended. People care. Okay. I don't regret it, because that's a good lesson, right?
Sure. Getting back to the whole cannabis thing, how many players do you think in the NFL percentage use marijuana, Rick?
It's got to be a 75.
75%.
Why wouldn't you? You know, because if you look at the other 25%, they're using Vicodin and Ambien, right? It's like everyone in the NFL is in pain. That's what we do. And so all of us have to figure out some way to manage the pain and the stress and all of that. We have to. I mean, it's a reality. And I think if the ones that are smart are using cannabis.
Did you ever wonder at any point if you would make it through a season physically?
I probably should have, but no. Oh my God. This is my mentality. You know, I just thought I could deal with anything. I mean, I could take on anything. So no, never crossed my mind.
And there were times with the Saints that you were beat up very badly and still continued to play. You weren't going to come off the field, right?
Yeah, I'm not coming off the field. Like I said, I played the last couple of games with broken ribs, you know? I go back and watch the film and I'm like, what was I doing? You know, like.
You know, I know you know this here, but the people still love you here. It's amazing all those years later. It didn't go as well as you wanted and they wanted, but I still think they have genuine affection for you. Do you agree?
Yeah, I do. I mean, I think they should. I mean, maybe I wasn't the kindest person all the time, but at least on the football field, you know, I gave everything I had to contribute and to win. And I think as a fan, that's all you can really ask for from your players.